Hello, I'm Walter Cronkite. I'd like to spend a few minutes with you exploring an extraordinary time in the story of America. World War I, the first major war of the 20th century, presented formidable challenges that demanded sacrifices from all Americans. This nation rose to meet those challenges with characteristic valor, both on the home front and the battlefield. Thanks to this dedication, the United States emerged from that war stronger and more deeply committed to the ideals of freedom. To all those Americans who served, especially those who lost their lives in the cause for liberty, for which they fought, this Liberty Memorial in Kansas City stands as a lasting monument. World War I was the nation's first major foreign war. It had been raging for almost 3 years before the United States joined the fight. When the Americans arrived in France, they found scenes of utter devastation. How the war started is well known. In 1914, a Bosnian Serb nationalist named Gavrilo Princip assassinated Archduke Franz Ferdinand, heir to the throne of Austria-Hungary. 1 month after the assassination, Austria declared war on Serbia. Within days, Russia, France, and Great Britain were allied on Serbia's side. Germany and Austria-Hungary, the Central Powers, were on the other. Since Europe had imperial interests around the world, the war quickly spread. Eventually, 32 countries would join the fight. Industrialized warfare had completely outpaced traditional strategies of attacking the enemy. At the beginning of the war, armies were still using tactics developed by Napoleon a century earlier, where infantry and cavalry tried to encircle the enemy. But World War I would be completely different. In the fall of 1914, following a burst of rapid German advances, the conflict degenerated into a stalemate. Each army dug an unbroken line of trenches protected by barbed wire. The defensive side had the advantage. Artillery and machine guns slaughtered infantry as it advanced across the battlefield. Paul Melber, a German machine gunner, described fending off an attack.
They're coming. Everyone is shooting, throwing grenades. All hell has been let loose. We've already fired 500 rounds with the machine gun. My loader fumbles with a new box of ammunition, finally shoving the belt into the gun's feed block. A jam. The belt is wet. Rip it out, pushing in a new one. The machine gun is thrown back up on the crater's edge.
Artillery inflicted most of the war's casualties. Modern recoil mechanisms allowed gunners to shoot off round after round in rapid succession. At the Battle of the Somme in July 1916, artillery crews fired at an incredible rate of 1 million shells a day. To break the stalemate of trench warfare, Germans began using poison gas. The other armies quickly followed. But gas was not a reliable weapon. The wind could carry it in any direction, killing both friend and foe. Tanks as armored machine gun platforms were another innovation used to breach the trenches. But they would need many technical improvements before they would be effective weapons. With the battlefront stalemated, the home front could determine victory. For the first time, countries mobilized their entire population for one purpose, warfare, keeping their armies and navies supplied with weapons, ammunition, clothing, and food. Civilians became targets for enemy raids far behind the front lines. The Germans shelled French and Belgian cities with long-range artillery and bombarded Britain from battleships and Zeppelin airships. Britain's navy blockaded Germany, starving it of food and raw materials for its industry. Germany's solution to the blockade was unrestricted submarine warfare. It hoped to break the Allied home front before the German home front gave way. U-boat attacks against U.S. ships began in February 1917. In March alone, three American vessels were sunk. In April, the United States declared war. For President Woodrow Wilson and many Americans, it was a wrenching decision. But once war was declared, a torrent of patriotism overwhelmed anti-war sentiments. When the United States declared war, it had virtually no army. But within 18 months, it raised, trained, equipped, and transported a force of 2 million troops to the battlefields of northern France. Their ranks included 25,000 American women who volunteered as medical, communications, and transportation personnel. American soldiers became famous for their courage. Legend has it that when a French commander ordered a retreat, the Americans replied, "Hell no, we just got here." The Yanks arrived at a critical time. Russia, after the Communist Revolution, had withdrawn from the war in March 1918. This allowed Germany to bring troops from the Russian front to France for a major offensive. The American Expeditionary Forces, under the command of General John J. Pershing, made the decisive difference for the Allies. In June 1918, U.S. troops drove back the Germans at Chateau Thierry. In July and August, British, French, and American armies, backed by tanks, launched massive counterattacks. By fall, with command of the air, thanks to flying aces such as Captain Eddie Rickenbacker, the Allies started to push back the Germans all across the Western Front. U.S. troops took St. Mihiel in September. The big push came in October and November in the Meuse-Argonne offensive. About 900,000 U.S. troops saw heavy fighting as they broke through the German lines. In a letter home, Corporal John Barclay showed the spirit of the American troops. He wrote to his brother,
"How would you like to have been in the Battle of the Argonne? There was a barrage from both sides of shrapnel and the biggest of guns. The Germans shot some of the damnedest shells at us, bigger than nail kegs and four times as long. And when they hit, you had better watch out."
Barclay would be awarded a Medal of Honor for his bravery during the Meuse-Argonne offensive. As the Allies gained strength, the Central Powers capitulated. In early November, Austria-Hungary withdrew from the war. And by November 11th, racked by revolts at home and pushed back almost to its borders, Germany agreed to an armistice. In June 1919, the Treaty of Versailles was signed. After 4 years of savage fighting, the war finally was over. World War I marks a great divide in modern history. The size of the armies, the scale of the losses, and drain on whole societies made it unlike any previous conflict. Around 9 million people were killed, and millions more were injured and disfigured. The vast cemeteries and seas of white crosses in northern France were their first memorials. In Kansas City, civic leaders started plans for a memorial just 2 weeks after the armistice. In 1921, the site was dedicated, attended by General Pershing and Allied commanders from Belgium, Italy, France, and Great Britain. More than 100,000 people turned out for the ceremony. The recent restoration of the Liberty Memorial has returned it to its original splendor. And a major new museum space is being constructed under the memorial's main courtyard. Soon, much of the museum's unparalleled collection will be exhibited here for the first time. As historian Shirley Williams said, "The books, the poetry, the artifacts of those 4.5 years of the Great War still speak to young men and women." The Liberty Memorial is a symbol not of war, its founder said, but of peace and the dawn of an era of peace.